What is the benefit of memoQ for freelancers? Coming up. Hello and welcome back to the Freelanceverse. As you can see, the first time in a new surrounding, we did some changing in the office. New year, new structure, I guess. It's much different. I'm facing the window now, so you will have a different background in the videos. A lot will still change in the background over the videos. You will see the progression, I guess, especially in that corner there. But it gives me more freedom to film, and it's also a much better guest room now. Today I had the pleasure to sit down with Peter Reynolds, the co-CEO of memoQ, for an interview. We talked about the strategy of memoQ, the beginnings, how he sees the future, and also what memoQ can do for freelancers, what freelancers mean to the company, etc. A really interesting talk about the language industry that all of you guys should be interested in, so I hope you will enjoy it. Make sure to subscribe to the Freelanceverse if you haven't yet, and I hope you enjoyed the talk. So we are joined by Peter Reynolds today. Thanks so much, Peter, for coming on the channel. Where do you join us from today?
Thank you for having me. I'm currently in Budapest, the headquarters of memoQ. I normally don't work from here, but today I'm here.
Oh, okay. Where do you work from usually?
I live in Warsaw and work from home.
Okay, lovely. So people, if they follow my channel, they have seen you already on here. You were featured in the memoQ Fest video that went up on my channel. Can you tell us a bit about your background? What led you to memoQ in the first place?
I had a number of different jobs, mainly in social work until about mid-90s. And then I worked for a company in Ireland called Softrans, which was selling translation services to software companies. And they went around the world telling people about this thing called localization that nobody had ever heard of, and effectively created a branch of our industry. Obviously, they were copied quite quickly after that, and the company initially got sold to Berlitz, then to Bound Global Solutions, and then to Linebridge. And okay. I stayed there for about 10 years, and after that joined a company. Linebridge was based in Waltham, Massachusetts, and I joined another company based in Waltham, Massachusetts called Idiom, and worked there for a couple of years until it was acquired by SDL. And at that stage, memoQ approached me. They were a tiny little company based in Gyula, Hungary. We had joked with them. Myself and a colleague from Idiom had met them earlier. We had joked with them that memoQ was based in one of their mother's garages. And I only realized after I'd actually joined the company that this was true.
Some of the biggest companies started in garages, no?
Well, when I joined memoQ, it was a bit unclear about what they wanted to, who was the customer, what they were targeting. And we sat down and looked at what all our competitors were doing and realized that at the time, everybody wanted to either get to the enterprise or get to the translator. Like SDL wanted to both enterprise and translator. Cross was targeting the enterprise. Deja Vu was targeting the translator. So we came to the conclusion that there was a market for us with LSPs, and that this was quite interesting because nobody was targeting them, and we didn't know why, because they spent money on technology. So we started doing this, and it worked, and it worked so well that other companies quickly developed and copied our strategy.
Okay, and would you say that was kind of the breakthrough moment for memoQ to target this new niche that no one else was looking at yet?
Yeah, they weren't a new niche, which was the interesting thing with it. We were also aiming at LSPs of a certain size, because some of the big LSPs had got their own solutions or whatever. Okay. It was a huge breakthrough for us. During those years, we quickly grew at 100% per year plus. Wow. We won Deloitte Awards for the fastest growing company, for the 50th fastest growing company in Europe 3 years in a row. And obviously, if you're at a small revenue figure and you grow 100%, that's a bit easier than, say, 10 years later when your revenues are much higher. You can't do that. It's not as easy. But
definitely. Yeah. Now you are acting co-CEO. Was this how you were brought onto the company, or did you have other functions first?
I've had a lot of functions in the company. My first role within the company was coming in to create a strategy for the for the company, and I've done quite a few other things in the company. About 2 years ago, Balaj Kish and I became co-CEOs. Previous that, we had a single CEO. Salesforce.com have got co-CEOs or have had co-CEOs. Netflix has got co-CEOs. Netflix got the idea from us, but don't tell anybody that. week after we decided we'd be co-CEOs, Netflix announced that they were doing it too. Part of the reason for this is there's a myth of a single brilliant leader. And usually that's wrong. There's no single brilliant leader within a company. It's a teamwork. It's people have to create a business is a creative collective, and it's not one individual. There, even people that were classed as geniuses, like Elon Musk, for example. It's quite clear that that there's a lot of it's not true. There isn't just one individual that can push a company, and it's been quite good working with Balaj. We've got different skills, different approaches, and I think we've really pushed the company forward.
Now we just entered a new year, 2023. Can you tell us a bit what's the plans, the goals of memoQ in this new year? Do you have overarching goals?
This year is the year that a lot of people are quite apprehensive about beginning, because the economy is quite unpredictable. Nobody's quite sure what will happen. We take this into account, understand this. My personal view is that won't be particularly bad for translation or translation technology. And the reason for this is I think people will more concerned about the economy will be trying to make sure that they maximize their business. And translating and getting their services and goods out to an international market is a very sensible way of doing this. So one of the things I think with this industry is that even if it's a bad year, it probably won't be particularly bad for our industry. We're working on what we call TM Plus, which we've been working on for the last number of years. Well, it's a powerful upgrade to our translation memory. As the TM gets used more and more, then it'll become more scalable. memoQ has been taking the view that the market that we're targeting, it's very much the premium translation sector. And what we mean by that is that you need a translator, a professional translator in the loop, and you probably also need professional project managers in the loop. And we've seen a lot in the last month since ChatGPT has released their AI engine. We've seen a lot of things where people have said, oh, this is fabulous, but you need a person. And you need a person controlling this with development coding, where people are saying, oh, this art AI engine can help write the code. But it can only do that providing there's a professional developer in control. Mm-hmm. And essentially, the way I see it is that this year, 2023, is the year of where the word augmented will be used a lot. We've been talking about for some time about augmented translation, meaning that the translator has a range of tools to help them, essentially like almost like a superpower, where the translator really uses technology that's out there, where it's machine translation, the QA functionality, any of that, just used in a way to make the translator much more powerful. And I think that's where we are with technology, with translation, that this is 2023 is the year of augmented translation.
Very good point, yeah. Definitely agree that especially ChatGPT needs supervision. I'm actually planning a video on it, so I'm doing a lot of research and experiments in it, and it's fascinating, but yeah, it's nowhere near to just at the point where you can let it run on its own. One thing that I know is that memoQ at the end of last year, I think, released a new product called memoQ TMS. Right. Can you tell us a bit about this? What is the goal with this?
It's actually not a new product. We rebranded memoQ server and various, what we're talking about memoQ TMS is the translation management system. It's used for collaborative translating, for functionality where, say, a project manager or a vendor manager has to do, or where a translator is working on the QA functionality, the quality management functionality. MemoQ has always had all these very powerful collaborative functionalities that, say, would be used more by a translation company or an enterprise. If, for example, many translators, they get their MemoQ licenses through when they work with a particular company. Mm-hmm. When they submit, when they synchronize their TMs, the content in that TM is then shown, other translators can working on the same project can benefit from it. All translators can see the same terminology. There's a lot of powerful functionality there of having it as a collaborative tool, and that's what memoQ TMS is all about.
For us translators and for me and my viewers, MemoQ is just a cut tool in a way, right? We work with MemoQ Translator Pro. So it's always interesting to see the whole ecosystem behind it. I know it because I've worked in an agency before with MemoQ, with the server version. So I'm aware of it, but many of my viewers are not, right? They think that MemoQ on the client side, on the LSP side, looks exactly the same. So it's I think it's an interesting point for anyone that is working with a system like this to also want to see the other side. Speaking of freelancers, I wanted to ask you what do freelancers mean to the branch strategy of MemoQ? Is this sometimes it can feel like freelancers is they're such a small clientele, right? Can they even be interesting to a big company like MemoQ?
The whole ecosystem in terms of translation, the freelancers are an incredibly important part of that. They provide, among other things, a lot of the ideas. They're always entrepreneurs. It's often the case that sometimes what is a freelancer becomes a collection of freelancers working together. Sometimes becomes a company, sometimes becomes gets into other parts of work around in the translation industry. We have always tried to make sure that every time we have a release of MemoQ that it's relevant to enterprises, LSPs, and freelancers. We see freelancers as being incredibly important to the company. We've tried to make sure that we engage with them in a way where we're serious about listening to their ideas. And I personally feel we benefited a lot for that. So, it's really great that people that are working quite hard are willing to give back something to a company like ours to try to improve our tools. Yeah, I think freelancers are sort of the core of the industry. It's one of the things that's happening with this AI conversation is that's becoming more apparent. Like a couple of years ago, when we talked to people outside of the industry, they'd have ideas about how AI and machine translation would make the whole thing automated and there wouldn't really be a need for translation. But the last 2-3 years, knowledgeable people who have had limited contact with the translation industry start saying, you know, that they know how important it is to have the human in the loop and to have a professional translator there. And I can see that more and more, that freelance translators are going to be are being more appreciated recently because of, you know, the knowledge that you need to have a human in the loop.
Yeah, they are the backbone. And as you said, like, specializing is the key, right? If you want to stay relevant.
Yeah.
As you said, you mentioned it, most freelancers are entrepreneurs. And I can tell you from my statistics that most of my viewers are 18 to 34 year old language industry entrepreneurs. And to finish off the video, it's been going so quickly. Could you tell them your word of advice that you have? If you started in this industry today, do you have any tips that you wish you knew beforehand, or who to look up to, what to look out for, etc.?
I would not listen too much to pessimists. I started in this industry in 1995. Since then, I've been listening to an awful lot of people tell me that within 2 or 3 years, the whole industry is going to be gone the way we know it, because various technologies would just automate it. And what we're seeing is something quite different. We're seeing that the technology has made the professional translator much more relevant. So what I'd say to them is, don't listen to pessimists. Trust their instincts, educate themselves, learn as much as they can about what's out there, and also specialize.
Brilliant. Thank you very much, Peter. To all the viewers, if you want to reach out to him, I'm going to link all the links down below. Reach out to Peter, can reach out to memoQ. They're always very willing to help and open and friendly and kind people. Thanks so much for coming on.
Thank you.
It has been a pleasure. Any last words, Peter?
Just to thank you very much. And also thank you I enjoy channel whenever I get a chance to look at it, so thank you for that. I think it's really
That's
useful.
Amazing. Thank you very much. See you guys next Monday with the next video. Bye bye.